Your name, occupation, marital status, spouse occupation, if they have a spouse. I'm going to ask for if they have children and grandchildren, and then to break down age and gender. I'm going to ask where they live in this county. And then you all have been kind enough to give me a proposed question regarding media exposure. And I'll do that for statutory questions. And the question that I have before we get, is there anyone here who believes that they have heard about this case in the news or media, or heard about this case from any other source? The comments that will be during the general statutory questions to follow up, because it needs to be a general question rather than an individual one. But I can ask it individually if you want. I just think that might be a little more time consuming. What's the state's agenda?
The state thinks it's a good idea to do it with the statutory questions, Judge, and then we can make notes and then note or reserve those questions or take them up the appropriate time individually outside the presence of the other jurors.
And I'll go slow enough for you to make your appropriate notes.
Thank you.
What is the defense position?
That's fine.
Then it'll be done that way. And then we can, I have an idea that's going to take up the rest of the day. Since we still have work to do, we have a motion to reconsider a ruling as well as the motion to enforce the ruling that's in question. And we need to build a record about the excused jurors, which I think will take up our day. So, unless it goes really fast, I don't see you all getting into your individual general questions this afternoon. Furthermore, I don't think it's good to break those up particularly. So let's just sort of anticipate that we will have had a good and successful day if we do all that. All right. This is in the courtroom. Can we bring you this in? Yes, sir. I don't need your help right now.
Okay.
I may need later getting a computer up.
Okay.
But right now I can manage with my iPad.
I'll come back and check out.
Okay. You need to wait till tomorrow. Things will be a little less. Yeah, a lot of constellations right now. Thank you. Yes.
Thank you.
Be seated, please. Please be seated.
Good afternoon. My name is Chuck Boring. That's how it sounds. B-O-R-I-N-G. I'm Assistant District Attorney in Cobb County. Seated with me, I guess I'll let them introduce themselves.
Good afternoon. My name is Jesse Evans. I'm also with the Cobb County District Attorney's Office.
Good afternoon. Susan Treadway, also with the Cobb County District Attorney's Office.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. And for the defense as well, please.
Hey, I'm Max Kilgore. And I represent Ross Harris, and this is Ross on the far end in the red tie.
Good afternoon. My name is Brian Lupkin, also an attorney from Cobb County representing Mr. Harris.
And Mr. Harris has been introduced by the defense. There's another team that will be coming on the defense team. Carlos Rodriguez said we will see another attorney. Well, that won't be here tomorrow. But ultimately, there'll be another attorney. He'll be introduced to the appropriate people. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like each of you to please stand at this time so I can administer the appropriate oath to you. Each of you, all of y'all stand. All of y'all means everybody in Southern. We know this. Everybody raise your right hand, please. Ladies and gentlemen, you shall give true answers to all questions as may be asked by the court or its authority, including all questions asked by the parties or their attorneys concerning your qualifications as jurors in the case of the state of Georgia versus Justin Ross Harris. So help you God. You so swear in group one, in group two, and in group three. That's the last two rows. All right. Y'all please have a seat. We're in the process of doing what's called voir dire of the jury. Some people pronounce it voir dire. You may hear both phrases. It sort of depends on where you went to school. When I went to Georgia, so it's voir dire where you are. And voir dire is a jury selection process where the attorneys are given an opportunity to ask you questions. This is not for the purpose of prying into any of your personal affairs. The purpose of the jury voir dire questioning is to allow these attorneys to explore any possible knowledge, belief, or bias you may have about the parties, the witnesses, the lawyers, or any issues or subject matter concerning this particular case. Now, in that connection, we will be asked certain questions at the outset, and that those are referred to as the statutory questions, and I will do that momentarily. The statutory questions are specifically legally worded. They are required by state law to determine if a juror is disqualified. I want you to listen carefully to the wording of these questions And if they apply to you, please let us know, and that will be, I'll tell you at the proper time. But you'll do that by raising your hand. And I'll need you to hold it up until we've made any notes so that we know each person who may have an answer to the statutory questions. But bear in mind, as to the statutory questions, that you may and probably will later be asked more questions to fully develop that answer. Now, sometimes the questions can be misunderstood, so I want to talk about that for a moment. Be aware that it is not a disqualification if you have a bias or prejudice against any crime charged in the bill of indictment. No one's going to ask you to condone criminal conduct. The question relates to a bias or prejudice either for or against a party or witness, or to an inability of yours to follow and apply the law, and that is the subject of the question. At this time, I'm going to read to you the bill of indictment that's been returned in this case. Before I do that, I want to explain to you the impact and purpose and effect of a bill of indictment. A bill of indictment specifically sets out in the law, in the language that the law requires, the charges that are brought in a particular case. It is a charge. And in order for a case to go forward, there has to be a charge that sets forth, there has to be an indictment that sets forth the charges of the case. To these charges, the defendant will enter a plea of not guilty. The indictment and the charges in the indictment, together with the plea of not guilty, set forth and establish the issues of the case. And a jury will be selected from the number to listen to the evidence and hear the law and return a verdict based on evidence and law. So when I read to you this bill of indictment, you need to be aware and keep in mind this bill of indictment is not evidence or proof of anything. And the plea of not guilty is not evidence either. So as you hear this, keep in mind, this is not proof, this is not evidence. These are the charges of the case that the jury for your number will be selected in the trial of the case. So with that, I will read to you now the bill of indictment returned in this case. This is the general bill of indictment number 14-3124, State of Georgia versus Justin Ross Harris. State of Georgia, County of Cobb. In the Superior Court of State County, the grand jurors selected, chosen, and sworn for the County of Cobb to wit, and their names are listed thereafter on the second page of the bill of indictment. Count 1. The grand jurors aforesaid, in the name and behalf of the citizens of Georgia, charge and accuse Justin Ross Harris with the offense of malice murder, Official Code of Georgia Annotated Section 16-5-1, for the said accused person in the County of Cobb and State of Georgia, on or about the 18th day of June 2014, did unlawfully and with malice aforethought cause the death of Cooper Harris, a human being, by placing said Cooper Harris into a child car seat and leaving him alone in a hot motor vehicle, contrary to the laws of said state, the good order, peace, and dignity thereof. Count 2. And the grand jurors aforesaid, in the name and behalf of the citizens of Georgia, further charge and accuse Justin Ross Harris with the offense of felony murder, Official Code of Georgia's Annotated Section 16-5-1, for the said accused person in the County of Cobb and State of Georgia, on or about the 18th day of June 2014, did commit the offense of murder when the accused caused the death of Cooper Harris, a human being, while in the commission of a felony to wit, cruelty to children in the first degree, Official Code of Georgia Annotated Section 16-5-70, did maliciously cause Cooper Harris, a child under the age of 18 years, cruel and excessive physical pain by leaving said child alone in a hot motor vehicle, contrary to the laws of said state, good order, peace, and dignity thereof. count three. And the grand jurors aforesaid, in the name and behalf of the citizens of Georgia, for the charge and accused Justin Ross Harris with the offense of felony murder, official code of Georgia annotated 16-5-1, for that the said accused person in the county of Cobb and state of Georgia, on or about the 18th day of June 2014, did commit the offense of murder when the accused caused the death of Cooper Harris, a human being, or the commission of a felony, to wit, cruelty to children in the second degree, official code of Georgia annotated section 16-5-70, did with criminal negligence cause said Cooper Harris, a child under the age of 18 years, cruel and excessive physical pain by leaving said child alone in a hot motor vehicle, contrary to the laws of said state, the good order, peace, and dignity thereof. Count four. And the grand jurors aforesaid, in the name and behalf of the citizens of Georgia, further charge and accuse Justin Ross Harris with the offense of cruelty to children in the first degree, official code of Georgia annotated section 16-5-70B, for that the said accused person in the county of Cobb and state of Georgia, on or about the 18th day of June 2014, did maliciously cause Cooper Harris, a child under the age of 18 years, cruel and excessive physical pain by leaving said child alone in a hot motor vehicle, contrary to the laws of said state, the good order, peace, and dignity thereof. Count five. And the grand jurors aforesaid, in the name and behalf of the citizens of Georgia, for the charge and accuse Justin Ross Harris with the offense of cruelty to children in the second degree, official code of Georgia annotated section 16-5-70C, for that the said accused person in the county of Cobb and state of Georgia, on or about the 18th day of June 2014, did, with criminal negligence, cause Harris Cooper, a child under the age of 18 years, cruel and excessive physical pain by leaving said child alone in a hot motor vehicle, contrary to the laws of said state, the good order, peace, and dignity thereof. Count six. And the grand jurors aforesaid, in the name and behalf of the citizens of Georgia, for the charge and accused Justin Ross Harris with the offense of criminal attempt to commit felony, official code of Georgia annotated section 16-4-1, for that the said accused person in the county of Cobb and state of Georgia, between the first day of March 2014 and the 18th day of June 2014, did knowingly and intentionally attempt to commit the crime of sexual exploitation of children in violation of Code Section Official Code of Georgia annotated Section 16-12-100 of the Official Code of Georgia, in that the said accused person did perform an act, to wit, the accused did request that Chelsea, a.k.a. Georgia Girl, 1997, a minor female under the age of 18 years, provide the accused with a photograph and visual medium involving the lewd exhibition of her genital and pubic area, an act which constitutes a substantial step for the commission of said crime, contrary to the laws of said state, the good order, peace, and dignity thereof. Count seven. And the grand jurors aforesaid, in the name and behalf of the citizens of Georgia, for the charge and accused Justin Ross Harris with the offense of dissemination of harmful material to minors, official code of Georgia annotated section 16-12-103, for the said accused person in the county of Cobb and state of Georgia, between the first day of March 2014 and the 11th day of June 2014, did knowingly disseminate and furnish to Georgia Girl 1997, a minor female under the age of 18 years, printed matter containing explicit and detailed verbal descriptions and narrative accounts of sexual excitement and sexual conduct in which, taken as a whole, is harmful to minors, contrary to the laws of said state, good order, peace, and dignity thereof. Count 8. And the grand jurors aforesaid, in the name and behalf of the citizens of Georgia, further charge and accuse Justin Ross Harris with the offense of dissemination of harmful material to minors, Judicial Code of Georgia, Section 16-12-103, for that the said accused person in the County of Cobb, State of Georgia, between the 6th day of March 2014 and the 15th day of June 2014, did knowingly disseminate and furnish to Georgia Girl 1997, a minor female under the age of 18 years, a photograph and visual image of a portion of the human body which depicted sexually explicit nudity, to wit, a photograph and visual image of a male in a state of undress so as to expose the male's genitals, and of a depiction of uncovered male genitals in a discernibly turgid state, and which, taken as a whole, is harmful to minors, contrary to the laws of said state, the good order, peace, and dignity thereof, signed D. Vincent Reynolds, District Attorney. Returned by Trueville of the Grand Jury of Cobb County, September 4, 2014. I'm going to now ask you the statutory qualifying questions concerning your jury service, your voir dire, and I'm going to ask you these questions collectively, which means I'm going to put out one question at a time. I'll tell you the question, I'll tell you the answer, and then I'm going to look at each group. One, I'm going to call y'all one. The first two rows, I'm going to call y'all two. The second two rows, I'm going to call y'all three. So I'll ask the question, I'll tell you the answer I'm looking for, I'll look to group one, and if that is your answer that I've stated, hold your hand up and make sure we've made a note of who you are before you lower your hand. I'll say you may lower your hand. And then we'll go to two. The first question deals with relationships by blood or marriage. And I want to know if you or any of you are related by blood or marriage to the defendant, Justin Ross Harris. He's been introduced to you. And if it group one is related to him by blood or marriage, please raise your hand. Let the record reflect no one has raised their hand. Group two, if you are related to the defendant, Justin Ross Harris, by blood or marriage, please raise your hand. No one has raised their hand. Group three, if you are related to the defendant, Justin Ross Harris, by either blood or marriage, raise your hand in group three. No one in any of the groups have raised their hand. Next, I'm going to ask you about your relationship to Cooper Harris. And if you are related to him, blood or marriage, in group one, raise your hand. If you are related to him by either blood or marriage in group two, raise your hand. And the back two rows. If you are related to him by either blood or marriage in the back two rows, raise your hand. No one has raised their hand. Ladies and gentlemen, have you, for any reason, formed and expressed any opinion in regard to the guilt or innocence of the defendant? If you have done so in group one, raise your hand, please. Thank you very much. Are you Mr. Jones?
I am.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. with Ms. Parrish? You do not. Ms. Blazek? Is that with Ms. McCall? Ms. Hart? I'm calling for a phone, but you want me to call out the numbers?
Following.
You're comfortable?
Yes.
Group one and group two is down. And I want to leave questions in the first and most of the very carefully. Questions have you expressed, and that will be the verbal or said out loud. Have you, for any reason, formed that would be in your mind and expressed would be speak out loud any opinions regarding guilt or innocence of the defendant? So that's the question. Have you, for any reason, formed in your mind or expressed verbally out of your mouth any opinion about the guilt or innocence of the defendant? And if you have, in the words two, stand up. For any reason, formed in your mind and expressed verbally any opinion regarding the guilt or innocence of the defendant in the last two rows, the dark group, will be considered. And of course, as I told you, we'll come back to this for more questioning on that. Deputy Sheffield? Ms. Cody? And Mr. Jacobs? Is that the... Yeah, is Mr. Jacobs? Thank you, sir. Ms. Gorilla?
Yes.
Ms. Walsh?
Yes.
And Ms. Anya? Scott Hucka? Oh, yes. Yeah, no, sir. I've got Michael coming down. Okay, y'all have a seat. Mr. Anderson? Is that correct?
Yes.
Ms. Flores?
Yes.
Is it Ms. Glover?
Glover. Yes.
Glover, I'm sorry. And I promise you I'll mess that up 100 times. You didn't have to help me do it right. Is that Ms. Glover?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Y'all all have a seat. Thank you. All right, the next question is, have you any prejudice or bias resting on your mind, either for or against the defendant, this particular person who is questioning Ross Harris. Do you have any prejudice or bias against the defendant, Justin Ross Harris? He was one of you. No one has affirmed. No one stood up or raised a hand. In group two, do you have any prejudice or bias either for or against this defendant, Justin Ross Harris? And if you do, stand up, please. And in the last group, do you have any prejudice or bias resting on your mind either for or against this defendant, Justin Ross Harris? No one has stood up. My next question. Is your mind perfectly impartial between the state, the prosecution, and the defendant in the case? And that would be the defendant, Justin Ross Harris. Now, to get you to where you can answer it, I have to turn the question a little bit. If you are not perfectly impartial between the state of Georgia and the defendant, Justin Ross Harris, and you are in group one, I guess it's only fair to make you stand rather than wait for your hands. So if you fall in that category, please stand. But no one just stood up. Group two, if you are not perfectly impartial between the state of Georgia and the defendant, Justin Ross Harris, and you are in the first two rows, group two I'm calling you, please stand. No one just stood up. And in the last two rows, which I'm going to call group three, if you are not perfectly impartial between the state of Georgia and the defendant, Justin Ross Harris, please stand. No one has stood up. Hold on. Now, my next question. Is there anyone here who believes they have heard about this case in the news or media, or heard about this case from any other states? And so I guess the best way is for y'all to stand. In group one, is there any of you who believe that you have heard about this case in the news or media, or about this case from any other source? Right. Now let's go through this. This is going to be Mr. Jones.
Yes.
Why don't you have a seat, sir?
Thank you.
And that would be Ms. Green. Thank you, ma'am. Have a seat. And that would be Ms. Bismond. Thank you, ma'am. Have a seat. Mr. Is it Parshley? Have a seat, sir. Ms. Hunter? Thank you. That's Mr. Golden? Thank you, sir. Have a seat. In our back row, and Ms. Parrish? Is that correct? Have a seat. And Ms. Swizing? Have a seat, please. And Ms. March? Have a seat, please. Ms. McCullough? Thank you, ma'am. Have a seat. In the second group, is in the first two rows, you all were seated. Is there anyone here who believes that they have heard about this case in the news or media, or know about media, or know about this case from any other source? If you do, please stand in the two front rows, the two rows. Is that Mr. Grant? That would be Ms. Kern. That would be Ms. Howell. Is there anyone here who believes that they have heard about this case? And then it is on the map or heard about this case from any other source in the back two rows in its subtly speak. And would that be the Sheffield? Yes. Thank you, ma'am. Please have a seat. And Ms. Cody?
Yes.
Thank you. Have a seat. And Mr. Jenkins?
Yes.
Thank you, sir. Have a seat. And Mr. Little? Thank you, sir. Have a seat. Mr. Wong?
Yes.
Thank you, sir. Have a seat. Mr. Amanana? Thank you, Dr. Lee. Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Yes, sir. And now, Mr. Morris? To you during this process, and now I'm going to give you a chance to introduce yourself to us. Is call upon you one at a time, and when I do that, I'd like you to stand, and I will have three questions to ask you, and then I'll turn to sit and wait a moment because the lawyers will need to make their notes. And the more information that they gather now, the less likely they're to repeat a question. They don't want to do that. And what we've learned over time in selecting juries is that we'll go slowly and let them make their notes when there'll be less repetition and better use of your time. And I know you're just going to say those words out of my now. You're thinking, well, what best use of my time has there been today? But people have been working really, really hard to get y'all in here and get you doing something productive. And we hope that this is the beginning of a lot more of that. The beginning of jury selection is always very much what you saw this morning. And I want to compliment the people here that worked with you that did a good job. So we will begin with juror number one, and that will be Ernest Stoddard Jones. Mr. Jones, would you stand? Sir, did I say your name correctly?
You did.
Thank you. What is your occupation?
Retired.
What did you retire from?
Last name is AT&T.
And are you married, sir?
I am.
What is your spouse's occupation?
She is also retired.
What did she retire from?
She was an instructor.
Do you have children?
I do.
Would you tell us how many, age and gender, if you don't mind? Well, I might get mad at you. We'll have to see.
Yeah, I have five children.
Do you want to just give us maybe an age range?
Well, one was born in 73, one in 76, one in 78, one in 80, and the last one in 82.
And are they boys and girls?
It's a mixture. I have three boys and two girls.
Do you have grandchildren?
I do.
Could you tell us about them in terms of gender and age?
Oh, man, it's getting tough.
I'm being really mean, aren't I?
Well, the first two was a boy and a girl. And after that, we had another girl and another boy. And then we had a set of twins who were not in
And what are their age ranges? You can guess, and we won't tell. We won't tell their mothers.
Oh, yeah, my wife, my wife
did that. You get in a mess of trouble with that.
The oldest one graduated from high school, so he's close to 17, I guess. And the you're talking about my kid, grandkids?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, 17. And the youngest one's three.
Now, what part of Camden County do you live in?
Green County?
No, I'm sorry. It's been a long day for me, too. Yes, I'm more interested in Glenn than I am Camden. What part of Glenn? I'm going to mess that up every time. What part of Glenn County do you live in?
I live on St. Simons.
Very good. I think that those are the questions I have of the sort of business. Here are number two. Is it Joy? Is that correct? Please stand up. And I said your name correctly. What's your occupation, Ms. Green? What type of work do you normally do?
I recently worked in what?
eBay, like on buying stuff off of the internet? Are you married? And do you have children?
Mm-hmm.
Where in Glenn County do you live?
17. I
live 17. Okay. We're not from around here. Can you give us a little better idea? Here's Brunswick, and we're sitting in Brunswick. And 17 goes through, and it goes north and south, right?
Yes.
Are you heading up toward, like, Darien? Or are you heading down toward, like, Florida?
No, up toward.
There you go.
It's right up toward. I'm not explaining. 303?
Is it fairly close to Brunswick?
Yes.
Okay. I think we're educating ourselves. We really do want to know. I'm not trying to put you on the spot. Very good. Thank you so much.
Yes.
Juror number three. I guess I need to start using initials. We're going to revert from initials for your privacy. Made a lapse. Juror C. D. Miss D. What's your occupation?
Retired lawmaker. So I haven't really retired.
When you said that, I'm like, you can give us all the tips I'd like to know. Well, is it pleasurable to be a retired home member?
It's different because my husband's also retired.
Well, then you're not retired at all.
No.
You need to get rid of that retired part.
Okay.
Have you been a homemaker all along then?
Pretty much. I mean, I worked at the hospital doing coding, and I worked in real estate for a little while. Did some retail work, but, not a major career.
Okay, but some dabbling in things that were of interest to you.
Yes.
And I think it means that you're married.
Yes.
And your husband's occupation?
He's retired. He worked as a structural engineer over at...
Children?
Two boys, 50 and 48.
And grandchildren?
Four. Two twin girls that are about 22, and two boys that are, let's see, what's eighth grade? 13.
Yep.
And 11.
And what part of laying down?
St. Simon's.
Thank you. What is your occupation?
I'm an automotive technician.
And are you married?
Never.
Do you have children?
Never.
And What part of the county do you live in?
I live on Black Island.
Please be seated. Juror 5, M.H. What is your occupation?
I'm Sasha Davis.
And are you married?
I am.
And what's your husband's occupation?
He is a planner of historic preservations.
This is a great place to do that.
Yes,
it really is. Children?
The two. Our daughter's 17, our son's 15.
Mm-hmm. You have grandchildren?
No.
In that age group, it's just
I know.
It's so difficult to answer that. You wait for somebody to see you to follow the person. And then, what part of the county do you live in? Juror 6, Juror S.G. Right there. What is your occupation, sir?
Contractor.
And are you married?
I am.
What is your wife's occupation?
Realtor.
Children?
We have four.
Can you give me gender and age?
Well, my son's 34, daughter 33, my son 30, and so we have a sister.
Four grandchildren?
We've got three.
And what are their ages and genders?
3 girls, 13, 7, 3.
So, and what part of Lane County do you live in? Which way is that? Thank you so much. Have a seat, please, sir. Thank you. Juror 7, which is C.D., Juror C.D., 16. What is your occupation?
I'm a homemaker.
And are you married?
Yes, ma'am.
What is your spouse's occupation?
He travels with a contracting crew right now.
Children?
I have one.
How old?
She's 2.
What part of the county do you live in?
5341.
Okay. In town?
Yes, sir.
Very good. Thank you. Your occupation?
I'm a teacher.
What school are you in? High school, elementary?
High school. I teach 11th and 12th grade.
What do you teach?
English.
And are you married?
No.
Do you have children?
No.
Where in Lane County do you live?
San Francisco.
Thank you, and be seated. Juror 9, that would be Juror M.M. Your occupation?
House.
And are you married? What is your spouse's occupation?
He is a irrigation technician.
Children?
We're 15, 16, and
9. And no grandchildren? Well, I'm still gotta ask. And where in the county do you live? In where?
What?
I didn't mean
in Brunswick.
In Brunswick. Yeah. Thank you so much. Please be seated.
What is your occupation?
Was the judicial assistant at the hospital.
Are you married?
No.
Do you have children?
Yes, ma'am. I have three.
Tell me their ages.
I have a 10-year-old boy, a 9-year-old boy, and then a 6-year-old girl.
And what part of Greene County do you live in?
Right here in Boston.
In town?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you so much. You're 11. You're LH. What is your occupation?
I'm retired.
What did you retire from?
I was a legal secretary in Los Angeles, California.
What kind of law practice was that?
It was mostly breach of contract, public works and construction primarily, or bid disputes.
So it was civil and...
Civil.
No criminal?
No criminal, no family law, all strictly breach of contract.
Are you married?
Yes, I am.
Your husband's occupation?
He is retired, but he used to be a heavy lift truck salesman. You know, those are the really big forklifts.
Yeah.
Like in the port.
Oh.
Really big.
Really big.
They carry around containers.
Oh, I know that.
Or loads of pipe. Huge loads of pipe.
I know about those. They do the, on the trains. They pick the cargo part of the train off and they'll put it onto the truck. Yeah. All right. I do know that. And what part of the county do you live in?
We have no children.
Oh, it's been a long day for me too. Longer for y'all. I know you feel like you, but anyway.
Okay, Marshes of the K, which is like halfway between Brunswick and Derry.
Thank you so much, and thank you for being patient with me and my lapse. And then we have juror 12, which would be the. What is your occupation?
I am a trail guide. I take horseback rides and we just drink it for a
while. Oh, you have a terrible job. Did they just make you do that or what?
I can't really complain.
Are you married?
Yeah.
Children?
Yeah.
And what part of the county do you live in?
Out a little bit towards Sterling, if you know where that is. Sterling's right in between Desa, who runs like kind of a.
Oh, I do know where that is. Okay. All right, I think we all broke through it. All right, that is good. 12. And if the attorneys want to move around, it's fine. And if they don't, that's fine. But I'm getting ready to move on. This will be juror 13, and I believe your initials are going to be M-H.
Yes, ma'am.
Good, you've got the right person. It would be really bad if I'm looking that away and somebody stands up this way. So we're in good shape. What is your occupation, please?
I am the SM.
And are you married?
Yes, I am.
What is your spouse's occupation?
He's a retired, he's been air conditioned and now says he's disabled.
Do you have children?
Yes, I do.
How many and what are their genders and ages?
Three, two girls, two girls and a boy. And 31, 36, and 38.
Any grandchildren?
Yes, I do.
How many?
Five.
Tell us about them.
They are between the ages of 3 and 21.
Boys, girls?
The girl is 21. The girl is 21. She's in college, and I got one that's 19 in college, and I got a 30-year-old that stays with me, and a 13 and a 14.
And what part of the county do you live in?
I live in the Fairway Oaks subdivision over by Fleetwood.
Good. Thank you so much. Next is going to be juror 14.
would be CJ. Thank you. What is your occupation? Are you married?
Same.
Children?
One, yeah.
How old is your daughter?
34.
Do you have any grandchildren?
30.
Tell me their ages and genders, please.
My boy, 18. My girl, 16. And the other girl's 13.
What part of the county do you live in?
Glen.
And do you live in town?
I live there.
Thank you so much. Please be seated. Sure, 15. DG. What is your occupation, sir? Are you married?
I am.
And your wife's occupation?
Primarily homemaker. She works part-time at our daughter's school.
Children?
Two little girls, 6 and 8.
And what part of the county do you live in?
Southwest Glen.
What is that down like for, not St. Mary's, but?
Not that far south.
Not that far south, like that for?
There's 17 and 82. Split 82 goes west up about 82.
Is that like for, okay.
Heads towards Lake Ross.
Okay. I didn't know where that is.
Okay,
I've been to the Okefenokee Swamp. I saw an alligator. I saw a lot of alligators. Thank you very much. Juror 16, SC, is that correct? Your occupation, please.
I'm a customer service rep.
Pardon me.
Yes.
Your husband's occupation?
He is a chemical operator.
Children?
One.
Boy, girl?
One.
And how old is he?
16.
And grandchildren?
No.
Sorry. Yeah. And could you tell me what part of Green County do you live in?
I stay in this area.
In the Brunswick area? Thank you so much. Please be seated. Moving to juror 17, LF. Is that correct?
Yes.
Your occupation, please?
Kindergarten teacher.
And are you married?
Yes.
Your husband's occupation?
He's retired, water inspector.
Children?
Nothing.
And what part of Bill County do you live in?
St. Thomas.
That's it.
Thank you.
If we can go to juror 18, CC, is that correct? Your occupation?
Something to do with internet sales.
Are you married?
I am.
And your spouse's occupation?
Waitress.
Children?
No children.
What part of the county do you live in?
About a mile from here.
Perfect. Thank you so much, and be seated, sir. If we can move to the next juror, that would be 19. AS, how are you this afternoon? Your occupation?
Yes, I teach at a private school in Brunswick, and I teach middle school.
Middle school. Mm-hmm. What do you teach?
Science.
Are you married?
Yes, ma'am.
What is your spouse's occupation?
General contractor.
Children?
I have three. My son is 21, and I have three stepchildren ranging up to 37 years old.
Do you have grandchildren?
I do, yes, ma'am. A 6-year-old boy and a 3-year-old boy.
What part of the county do you live in?
St. Edward Town.
And I'll be seated. Juror 20, juror HD, initials, is that correct? What's your occupation?
I don't have it.
Are you married?
Yes, ma'am.
Who's best is occupation?
He works security at the fort.
Children?
Yeah, we have four. I guess I should say four. We have one that passed away in the city, and I have my daughter, and she will be grieving this month. And I just had my son 3 months ago, and then I have a 12-year-old stepson that we have custody of.
What part of the county do you live in?
We live off 17. If you're like coming off the islands and you're probably like you're going to go to Darien, we're kind of the last thing before it's just kind of open road.
Okay. Thank you so much. And please be seated. Next would be juror 21, WFD. Is that correct?
Yes.
What's your occupation?
I'm a veterinary assistant.
Are you married?
Yes.
Do you have any children? What part of the county do you live in?
Northern Brunswick.
Thank you, sir. Please be seated. Linda, can you be juror 22? Okay, is that correct? What is your occupation?
I guess you would say I was retired.
And are you married?
Yes.
And your husband's occupation?
He's retired. Sergeant Major Marine Corps and retired from the U.S. government.
Children?
Five.
Tell us about them. Just ages and genders. We'll make it so.
Okay. Four boys and one girl. One's the oldest is 42 and 35, 33, 28, which is my daughter. And my youngest one is 25.
Do you have grandchildren?
I have three.
And tell us about them.
I have a granddaughter that's 10 in California. And two boys. For my son lives here with us, and he's one of them's 3 years old, and the other is probably 2.5 weeks.
Oh, my goodness. Congratulations.
Yes.
Thank you. Have a seat.
Thank you.
Here is 23.
Yes, ma'am.
How are you?
Okay.
What is your occupation?
I'm a registrar secretary for Brunswick High School here in Brunswick County.
And are you married?
Yes, ma'am. My husband is a retired longshoreman from New Jersey.
And children?
Yes, I have two boys, 46 and 47.
And do you have grandchildren?
Yes, I do. I have two granddaughters and four grandsons. Granddaughters 14, 21, grandsons 22,
24, 25, 27. Okay. And what part of the county do you live in?
I live out by Flea Tech. I did, what did I say, Country Woods.
Okay, good. Thank you. Juror 24, P.O. What is your occupation?
I'm in building maintenance.
Are you married, sir?
Yes, ma'am.
Wife's occupation?
She's in banking.
Children?
She has a 10-year-old boy and a 12-year-old daughter.
And what part of the county do you live in?
The Brunswick, I work in the Gidget area.
Thank you so much. You'll be seated. Juror 25, yes. What is your occupation?
I'm retired. I work on Sea Island in St. John, but I'm originally from St. John. But I've lived here in Brunswick for the last 17 years. And my husband is deceased. He too, I have two sons. One is 45, and another one will be 50 in November. And I have one granddaughter, she's 15 years old. And I live near downtown Brunswick.
Wonderful. And your occupation, you're still...
I work in a private home on Sea Island.
And then you're working...
I said domestic.
Okay.
So then...
Well, I think it's fabulous. There's no work, it ain't wonderful. Work is a good thing.
Oh, yeah.
And you said that your, I didn't hear what your deceased husband did.
He was in landscape, but he died 17 years ago, so.
And I moved to Brownsville. Thank you so much. Juror 26, KC, is that correct? Your occupation?
I'm retired.
From what?
I work in the financial business.
Are you married?
Yes.
Your husband's occupation?
He's retired.
And from what?
He had a business, he was self-employed.
Self-employed. And what type of business was that that he had?
He had a convenience store.
Children?
I have two boys, 48 and 43.
And grandchildren?
I have five. Three girls, 18, 13, and 10, and two boys, 16 and 12.
Harley County, do you live in?
Life Island.
Thank you, and have a seat. Juror 27, JJ, is that correct? What's your occupation?
I'm a draftsman.
Are you married, sir?
Yes.
Your wife's occupation?
She's a nurse.
Children? What part of the county do you live in?
Palm Lake, Stevens.
Is that near here?
Yeah, near the city, probably.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for bearing with me. Well, I can certainly work this stuff. Juror 28, Jada, what is your occupation?
I'm self-employed. My son is called Custom Weight Treatments.
Are you married?
I am.
Your wife's occupation?
She's a retired school teacher and takes care of our 14-year-old granddaughter. I mean, my 14-month-old granddaughter. Sorry.
You know, there's a big difference. It's like there's between Lynn and Camden County. There's a big difference. And what age children did she teach?
She taught elementary school. And I have two children. My son's 38 and my daughter's 34. I have three grandchildren. My grandson is 7. And I've got a granddaughter of 4. And of course, the one who keep this 14 months.
14 months, yes. And what part of the county do you live in?
I live down in the south end of the county, almost to Camden County.
Thank you so much. Juror 29, J.W. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am.
Your occupation, please.
I'm a registered nurse.
And are you married, sir?
I am.
Your spouse's occupation?
She is a respiratory therapist in dental sleep medicine. Three children, 36-year-old daughter, 33-year-old daughter, 29-year-old son, five grandchildren. The boys are identical twins at 3, 4, 7 and a 2-week-old granddaughter.
So, 3 boys and 1 granddaughter, is that what? Or, no, 4. 4 boys.
4 boys, 1 granddaughter.
That's well when you correct.
And I live in Marshall, Texas.
Okay. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Juror 30, Lynn A., is that correct? Occupation?
I was a school teacher.
Which age group were you teaching?
Second grade.
Are you married?
Yes, ma'am.
Are your spouse's occupation?
Retired law enforcement.
What type of affiliation in law enforcement?
He was sheriff. He was U.S. Marshal, and then he worked out at PCD and TSA.
Children?
Two children. A boy, 33, and a daughter, 27.
grandchildren.
Two grandchildren, a boy, 2 years old, and a little girl, 2 months old.
And where do you live?
St. Thomas.
Thank you. I think we can move forward. Juror 31, WA. Your occupation, please.
I'm a landscape architect.
Are you married?
I'm not.
And children?
No children.
What part of the county do you live in?
St. Thomas.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Juror 32, CD. What is your occupation, sir?
I'm a landscape.
And are you married? Children?
No.
What part of the county do you live in?
Brooklyn.
Thank you, sir. Juror 33, BH. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am.
What is your occupation?
Retired city of Brunswick employee. Return back to work as a night worker.
And are you married?
No.
Children?
Yes.
Tell us.
A girl and a boy. The girl is 28, the boy is 32. And I have 3 grandkids, 2 girls and 1 boy. The boy is 6, and the 2 girls, 1 is 8, and the 1 is 10.
Thank you, so be seated. Juror 34, LL. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am.
Occupation, please.
Yes, associate.
Are you married?
I'm married.
Tell me,
your husband's a landscaper.
Children?
I have 2. I have a 19-year-old daughter and a 14-year-old son.
Any grandchildren?
No.
What part of the county do you live in?
Off Highway 82.
Thank you very much. Juror 35, RM. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am.
What is your occupation?
My wife and I are ministers with Open Ministry, and we do electronic repair and small engine repair. We do it to feet or knee.
Thank you. Children?
Amen.
What part of the county do you live in?
Ballard.
Thank you, sir. Oh, well, let me ask you. I act like I know where Ballard is. I don't. Is it north, east, south, or west? Is
go up 341. You get your pumpkin patch. Turn right. You see Ballard Fire Department on one side, Ballard School on the other side. Move down there.
I've seen that. I know where pumpkin patch. Oh, thank you. All right. Good. 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 And I think we can call upon the last juror. Juror 36, MB.
Yes, ma'am.
What is your occupation?
I'm a kindergarten teacher and a middle school cheer coach at Frederick Academy.
Are you married?
Yes.
Your spouse's occupation?
He works in his family's business. They're electrical contractors.
Do you have children?
Yes, I have 2 boys. 5 and 3.
What part of the county do you live in?
St. Thomas.
Thank you, and have a seat. Okay, council vote.
Thank you all for being such pleasant and positive folks to work with. It's been a demanding day for all involved.
Now, don't think you're walking out of here not coming back. Because, yes, you're walking out of here today, but I'll meet you back in the morning. Want you all back at 8:50 in the jury assembly room. Let me give you some instructions before we go. You are officially a part of this case. You've been brought here under proper summons and subpoena. Fed in your brain, open mind. I have to be open minded. This is a fairness component and required of all of us. Secondly, have no contact of any sort whatsoever with the parties or attorneys or any of us. You've seen our faces long enough to want to turn and run when you see us. So you don't have to run, but turn and go the other way. And we'll do the same. It's not rudeness. It is a matter of actually great courtesy that we don't create a problem for you or for ourselves. Do not go on about any areas described in the bill of indictment. I don't think there were any, so you have no knowledge or awareness of that. When people become involved in legal matters, they are required to make sure that what they know about any given legal matter comes only from the court. And this is a legal matter. This is a case that's been brought to be tried shortly. And the only information that prospective jurors can have about the case has to come from this courtroom. Therefore, you are absolutely required to stay away from newspapers, to stay away from TV, to stay away from podcasts, radio, any sort of electronic media coverage, anything on the internet, and looking up in books, anything to do with topics raised in the case, or any other way. The way of doing research now is so broad that I could talk to you for an hour about don't do this and don't do that. And don't tweet, and don't Twitter, don't blog, nothing. Don't do it, and don't read about it, and don't expose yourself. You are now in the posture of being a prospective juror. You have to keep yourself in a posture to maintain fairness and neutrality and make sure that what you know comes from here and only here. And then the other thing is, don't talk to each other about this. Don't let others talk to you about the case. And that's going to be tough. When you go home, they're going to say, oh, what did you do today? Well, I can't tell you. Now, right now is when everybody's going to be curious. When the case is all over, you can talk about it to your total pleasure. Nobody's going to want to listen to you then. So I'll put you in that really rotten place. You've got to say, I can't talk to you about it. Now, let me explain to you why. There's a reason for every bit of this, and mostly it's designed to keep you fair, impartial, and open to the evidence that's going to be presented in this courtroom. If you start to talk to each other, you may express opinions that ultimately, when you've heard the evidence, it may not be your opinion, but it might be your opinion. But people have pride of opinion. You start talking about what you think in advance, and then you think, I didn't think about that. But then you're going, gosh, I hate to tell all these people when I, as my mama would say, shot off my mouth about that. My daddy would say, stuff your foot in your mouth, whichever expression fits within your family. You don't want to be there. You don't want to be that person who has said something and then wants to reconsider and then is uncomfortable in doing it. Not talking about it to each other preserves and protects you and the integrity of these proceedings. And it matters that we do things well, and we do things legally, and we do things carefully. And this helps you do things well, legally, and carefully. Now, why can't you talk to other people about it? Why can't I go home and call my mama? Call my mother all the time. Why can't I go home and call my mother and talk to her about this? Or, your sister, or your cousin, doing that, why can't I do that? Why can't I go home and talk to people I'm going to have supper with? They're not law. They're not here. They're not under oath. They have no requirements that you do to keep your standard of conduct really high. Not to suggest that they have low conduct. I'm not saying that. They have no requirements. And have you ever noticed that there's one thing that people will be real generous with, which is their opinion, especially if they have no responsibility for it. Have everybody I know say, I think this, that, and the other thing. And they're never going to have to take responsibility or accountability for that opinion. And if you're exposed to that, it may cause your ability to maintain an open mind, which you're required to do, become more complicated. So those are the reasons that you have to almost put yourself in a box, shield and protect yourself from receiving information, giving information, or talking to one another. And the reasons these rules have been developed is over hundreds of years of American jurisprudence. These conduct requirements have proven consistently to be the best way to create a situation where what happens in courts of law across this nation occur with integrity and are appropriate under the law, which is what we want to do. I hate to sound so serious about it and important about it, but it is serious and it is important. And if I don't tell you and then something happens, you can look right at me and say, well, you didn't bother to tell me what you expect out of me. And that would be fair, and I would own it. But now I told you. So I've sort of shifted the burden just a little bit. And then finally, I would say, I hope you all have a lot of fun. I hope it's just as pleasant as it can be. And then I will look forward to seeing you all in the morning, 8:50, jury assembly room, and we'll pick up and resume our work. Thank you all, and have a good evening.
I want to thank you all for keeping the pace. We kept the pace and we did what we set out to do. Now we have a few things. I think the simple thing to do is to build a record from those that were excused this morning. And then we can talk about when we have a hearing from them on outstanding motion. And I think I saw somebody put an extra motion on my desk from the defense. So let's talk about that next after we do this.
With DB number six at, and then we got a flash, and then we started back at the end. Within it, yes.
Right, and would you concur in that, Mr. President?
Yes, ma'am.
NN is a primary caregiver of her husband. He has a stroke victim. We all agreed there was no legal cause, and so she's been put in the jury pool, the prospective jury pool. Would that be a fair statement for the state?
Yes, Your Honor.
For the defense?
Yes, ma'am.
I'm going through this. Either of you want to supplement on that, you're welcome to do so.
Judge, I guess the only thing I would ask.
Yeah.
Is there going to be a mechanism for us to identify?
Yes, Mr. Sharon, it's going to get you all more than this. We'll just have to come up with a reasonable time period because they didn't squawk us the rest of us. They're wanting to start it about. There's a lot of folks. And Mr. Gilmore, if I keep forgetting to do it, keep the money.
Yes, ma'am.
When do you think that might be, Mr. Sharon?
If we get out this evening, we'll have it first thing for them. I can give them the names now. I don't know if the press is in, but I can actually do it in half of yours.
How about after? Well, a list in the morning?
Morning's fine.
Okay. Mr. Sharon, do a list, give it to each side, and follow it with the clerk.
Okay.
And then we'll have a good record. Is that acceptable to all?
Yes.
Okay. Vietnam vet, takes hydrocodone every morning, falls asleep at quite a few health problems, I think it would be fair to say. When we need to be scanning episodes, is that the correct to say?
Yes, sir.
Is that the defense?
Yes, ma'am.
Your LW, they've been in a car body. And we instructed four of them to report back Wednesday at 9 a.m. with a medical note.
Correct.
Is that correct for the state and the defense?
Yes, sir. That's what I've got.
Juror LB is a clerk at the State Court of Glynn County, runs criminal courts. This week is difficult for her, but this was no legal excuse for the service. Would that be fair to say for the state?
Yes, ma'am.
For the defense?
Yes, ma'am.
Juror RS is an attorney, trial Wednesday court on Friday. These are not legal reasons for being excused, but we're going to try to accommodate this bill. Would that be fair to say for the state?
Yes, Your Honor.
Before the defense?
That's right.
Juror RO had a cruise scheduled October 8th through 16th. I believe you all reviewed the notice and commented that it was scheduled before the summons went out and that juror was excused by consent. Would that be fair for this? Truth of the state?
Yes, Your Honor.
For the defense, your MM, medical problems associated with service in Vietnam, doctor's appointment in the United States, and standing appointment. On Fridays at 8:30 to 10:30 near Glencoe, both parties agreed to excuse. Is that truth of the state?
Yes, Your Honor.
Truth of the defense?
Yes, ma'am.
Your RP runs a family owned. Short-handed, and it is not a reason to be excused. Would that be fair to say for the staff?
Yes, Your Honor.
And would that be fair to say for the defense?
RP?
Yeah.
That's right.
Yes, I'm sorry. Excuse me for saying yeah. Yes. And I did on y'all who said yeah. So I apologize. JY is an attorney. Thursday court hearings, Friday court hearings, Monday court hearings. October 3rd oral argument in the Supreme Court. And these are not legal grounds for being excused. We will walk around the conflicts. Is that what we agree to, counsel?
Yes, Your Honor.
State defense?
Yes, Your Honor.
Thank you. Juror WA, a pharmacist in Deering, They have lost pharmacists, they're shorthanded, turning away flu shots. This is not grounds for legal excuse. It is within the court's discretion to excuse people dealing with the public health and safety. The state and the defense both agreed the court had the discretion, but the defense objected to the court excusing the juror, and the court excused the juror under the state's objection. However, the state did agree that it was not only within my discretion, but the testimony of juror W.A. supported the court's exercise of discretion.
Judge, I think you had that backwards. It was the defense that objected. You said the state?
Yeah, that's what I meant.
We agree you absolutely have the discretion to make a finding based on public safety concerns. You have the discretion to do that. Our objection is we just don't think necessarily in this case that would necessarily be the appropriate finding, and so we're objecting on that basis.
Okay. Well, his testimony was that they were turning away people who are coming for flu shots, that from what I gather from his testimony, it's potentially an underserved community without the services of those people, that frankly, for prescriptions, it would be a little bit different. People were getting their prescriptions, and I did not gather from his testimony that prescriptions were being turned away, but flu shots were. And it is the beginning of flu season. And from what I gather from the jurors who are here, we have a more mature community than many other places. Those persons who are more mature are certainly in need of flu shots to protect their health. So that was the reasoning behind the court's decision to excuse juror W.A. The public health, and I note the defense's exception to the court's exercise of its discretion.
Judge, I just want to be clear on this, because when we were up there, I think it was specifically to this juror, the defense said you had discretion to this juror, whether they objected to it or not. So I would just like the record to reflect that that was my understanding. If we have some difference, we can call him, keep him on call, so he's not excused to put him to the back of the jury pool. I just don't want this to be an issue later.
Okay.
I think it's real clear. You have the discretion to make a finding on public safety or medical grounds. You can do that.
Well, I can.
I'm just
saying specifically to this one, though. Now he's saying that specific to this juror.
Let me see. I have the discretion. The question is, does this juror's testimony support the exercise of my discretion? And so, and my understanding was that was conceded. And if Mr. Boren and I misunderstood, then we can call that juror and put him on call and bring him back in for jury selection.
That's up to the court. I said that I agree you have the discretion to make such a finding. Mm-hmm. In this case, I'm objecting. I'm objecting to it. You've got the discretion. Objecting to it.
I know I have a discretion. I think what we're saying is that Mr. Boren and I had a completely different understanding, and that's why I'm making this record right now to be sure that we're all on the same page. And as to this particular person, we are not all on the same page. So, Mr. Sheriff, we're going to have to call Juror W.A. Mm-hmm. Put him into the group. Let's see if we even get to him. And if we do, gentlemen, I will personally tell him that I'll say something diplomatically where this is my fault and I'm sorry. So
run to
get, all of it. Yes. No, I can handle that. This is not a problem. If we get to him, I'll explain to him that there was a misunderstanding and apologize. And I think that's a fair statement. Okay. Okay.
put them at the end of the pool, and then we'll have to notify them that he's still on order.
Yeah. He has handled it diplomatically, but tell him that he's subject to being called up for the jury questioning process.
Okay.
Is that word satisfactory to us, though?
Yes, sir.
What time?
Juror CJ, small medical company. She does, medical practice, I'm sorry. Does surgical scheduling and maybe going on, maybe no. She did something else. Caregiver for grandchild, 7 years of age. This is not a legal excuse, so she's in the pool. Agreed by the party?
Yes, Your Honor. That's right.
You're a JF. Lucas is a juror that gave us the long list of medicine. I have not made it part of the record yet. Yeah, that's right. That's what it is. There are 11 pages of things. I hope we can have all of them. That have a lot of them. Counsel has given an opportunity to review those. And came to sidebar and said, they agreed for the juror to be excused. I had a note that there was a desire to build the record. I don't know if I've done it or not, Mr. Board.
I think that was just talking about what was going to, I think in detail about what medicines were there, in addition to what she talked about, there also looked to be some other medications, including Clonopin and some other things that actually Mr. Kilgore pointed out as well, that I think would have made, had an effect on her ability to sit as a juror as well.
Mm-hmm.
I think that was it. I think we agreed on the outcome.
I think it was also observed by the court that she appeared to be in some, I thought perhaps some passion was having trouble moving around. What else do we want to put on the record? Who's going to do the data?
Nothing from the state.
It was excused by agreement.
It was.
The court agreement.
And I'm going to put the information she gave us into the court's budget. Juror Dan, I'm working on this condo. It's going to be out from September 29 to 27. Has to evacuate. But it is his primary residence, so there's no legal cause. We're going to work with his schedule to the best that we can. Is that consistent with the notes of the state and
yes.
The agreement parties?
Yes, ma'am.
And what about the defense?
Yes, ma'am.
Georgia. Girl. Is it R-O? I have R-O.
That's okay.
It looks a little like a D with my handwriting. Out of town to see granddaughter Friday through Monday, not pause, will work around schedule. Is that consistent with the state's notes?
Yes, Your Honor.
The defendant's notes?
Yes, Judge.
Juror S.R. Wedding in Michigan. Tuesday, September 19th through Wednesday, September 26th. And both parties agreed that the juror be excused. Is that an accurate statement for the state?
Yes, Your Honor.
That was
stipulation, yeah.
Juror E.S. is traveling from September 29th to October 7th. That's a pleasure trip. And it was excused, but he was excused by consent. Approved for the state?
Yes, Judge.
For the defense?
Yes, ma'am.
Juror A.S. is a high school agri teacher. She's got two competitions. It's for students, two online courses at school, but she is part-time. This is a discretionary excusal, but neither party objected to the court doing so. Is that a fair statement for the state?
Yes, Your Honor.
And for the defense?
Yes, ma'am.
Your Honor, if you may, I did get the initials on that.
A.S.
A.S. Thank you.
You ready then, Mr. Sham? Shall I write?
If you just wait a second, Judge, we have to cross index from.
Oh, no. I'll give y'all my notes.
Yeah, if we can get that letter, then
will that work?
I think we have everything.
Okay. Juror J.J., sworn officer of Lee County Sheriff's Office, federal court security, federal marshal, co-certified, excused. State agree?
Yes, Judge.
Defense agree?
Yeah, Judge, he was statutorily excluded.
Yes, exactly. Court reporter's notes are probably to be more accurate than mine. Mine are very accurate, but she'll have it verbatim. Juror A.Q. has traffic court on Thursday, 9 a.m. We'll work with her schedule. State agree?
Yes, Judge.
Defense agree?
Yes, ma'am.
Juror C.L. has a workers' comp case. October 22nd, child support court, September 20th. Had injuries in January, he's not on medication, he has transportation issues through September 25th. There is no cause, we will work with his schedule. What does the state?
Agree.
Defense?
I had him as LL, but I could have just misheard that.
I have CL, what does the state?
CL. It's CL.
Okay. I agree with the court presentation of what we stipulated to.
Thank you. Juror C.G. is remodeling his home. He's the general contractor. Apparently, it's not appreciated at home how quickly it's moving apace, which if it started in April, bless their hearts, but it's not caused. And is that true for the state?
Yes, Judge.
And for the defense?
Yes, ma'am.
Juror P.W. is a caregiver of a 15-year-old twin daughter, which is not grounds for being excused. Fair to say by the state?
Yes, Judge.
And the defense?
Yes, ma'am.
Juror P.H., small electrical contractor, runs the office and payroll, taking online courses, signing court at 9 a.m. tomorrow. No grounds for cause. We'll work around her schedule. Is that what the state has for their votes?
Yes.
And the defense? Do you have more?
She needs to be in court at 9 o'clock tomorrow. Is that here she needs to be at 9 o'clock?
McIntosh.
No, it's just another county for her son.
Oh, that's right. And so we did not agree to excuse her?
No.
Correct.
Okay.
No, but we're going to try to help her if we can.
Right.
But she didn't just say she wanted to. She said she needed to be there. Well, so if we can help.
Well, that's just one day. She can come on Wednesday or Thursday.
Yeah, it's hard enough to have to do this, and then your whole life is totally disrupted, and nobody cares. All right. JD has a vacation leave in Wednesday, September 14th through September 20th, and then October 5 and 6th. To the Keys. I was looking at two keys. What does that mean? It's to the Keys, and we excuse that juror. Is that true, Mr.?
Yes,
sir. And true for the defendant. Juror JD, we have another JD. October 1 to 8 vacation, he was excused by agreement. True for the state?
Correct.
And the defense?
That's right.
Juror LG has a vacation 9-16 and 9-25, and then an October 15th and 19th wedding in Tennessee, excused by agreement of the parties. Is that true for the state?
Yes, Judge.
And for the defense?
Yes, ma'am.
Juror FA has a vacation October 10th through 14th, excused by agreement. True for the state?
Yes, Judge.
True for the defense?
Yes, ma'am.
Juror AT. My goodness. Okay, so he's working in Savannah. He starts working in Savannah on 9/19, which is Monday. It's a week from today. In law enforcement training, and he's a student, and so he was excused by agreement. Is that true for the state?
Yes, sir.
And true for the defense?
Yes, ma'am.
I think that concludes everything regarding the jurors for the day. So I think when the questions are concluded, the motion, and I think we've had enough for that. And the motion, I think, is going to take at least 20 minutes. And then is there a new motion that I saw? We don't want a new motion to that?
Judge, there was a new motion underneath, but it might be one that's going to be part of it, so I don't think it's going to be what we pick up.
I think anything I'll do this afternoon.
Today or tomorrow.
All right. Well, y'all can talk about the scheduling of the new motion, remember, because if there's going to be evidence, we all need some too. And it may be that we can do it at the end of the jury board hour. I don't know. You'll definitely need to have some answer. What about your timing on the 26th motion to reconsider and this motion to compel? When do you, when is your absolute need to know by ruling?
We don't have to do it today. Judge, we're just ready whenever. I mean, we'd like to do it at some point before we break. Not today, but after jury selection.
By the end of the week?
Yes, absolutely. That'd be great.
Okay. We'll find the time.
Thank you.
All right. Anything for the state that you retire for the day?
No, Your Honor.
Anything for the defense?
I know it's late in the day. You could just tell us how you see us proceeding tomorrow, because we've had some that have raised their hand on statutory questions, some that haven't, sort of logistically, how are you going to want us to do this?
I want you to do the full general and individual board hour before we sequester them on that topic. Like we did it before. No, we'll do 12 at a time. You'll do your individuals and then your generals. And then you're going to ask some questions. They're going to say, that's private to me. And then we'll do sequester for hire of the ones that were affirmative regarding the media and the ones that, you know, have you ever been a victim of a crime? Yes. Can you tell us about that? No. I consider it to be private and I want a little bit more privacy. And then I'll give you a sequester board hour of that person. We're doing 12 at a time. Why, do you have another suggestion?
My concern is not those that answered yes to the question of whether or not they've had some exposure to John X. My concern is those that answered affirmatively to the first statutory question under 15-12-164.
You can have a sequester board out on that. Yes, the question you're concerned about is having formed and expressed an opinion in regard to the reasons I've been accused. And I assume that we would take them individually, along with the media persons, and you would do the voir dire of them outside the presence of the other jurors, so that we won't contaminate people. But I don't want to do that first. I'd rather they get in here and get settled, knowing all that, listen to the questions, reflect on the seriousness of the matter and their civic duty and responsibility, because that tends to sharpen the need of careful reflection in your answers. I'm not sure I can say that any more positive.
I understand what the court's saying.
Do you have a concern or anything you want to raise up to me as an alternative?
Let me think about it. I understand what you're saying, but basically those two questions, we're going to stay away from following up on those questions or anything close to following up on those questions. We'll take those folks individually.
Yeah, just like you would a DP case, which is how you would handle that.
Okay.
And we'll put 12 in the box, so you'll have your 12. State will do, y'all may want to do it differently. Sometimes state does individuals, but the generals and then individuals. But maybe because it's such a long process, y'all do your generals, then you do your generals, then y'all do your individuals, then y'all do your individuals. Okay. That may be the better way to do it. And then we will know specifically who we need individuals sequestered for our of, and we'll call them in one at a time, and we'll address that then. Followed by those sides.
And Judge, our preference is going to be to do, because it's on the length of it, do general, state, then defense, do general, then follow up with individuals. So I think that'll stop back and forth, depending on general questions. And
individuals. Oh, that's exactly what I had in mind. I wasn't going to have, you asked your number one general questions, then is that what you were thinking I was saying?
No, Judge. I know sometimes we do it where we do general, then the state stays up there and does individual, and so.
I just said no.
Okay.
Don't do that. This isn't that case. It's not a case where you can pick a jury in one day or two, obviously. So there's no reason to do that, because the reason you do it the other way is when it's going to be a relatively short voir dire and you don't have as much hopping up and down and jurors having to go back and forth, well, who am I talking to now? In this situation, I think it's what we did the last time anyway, so it makes more sense to me. You all ask your generals, you follow up with generals, and you all come into your individuals, and then I'll send whoever, the one person, we're not going to have individual court person, or whomever, however many, I'll send them somewhere, and I'll put the others in the jury room and bring them in one at a time. Move through it. And it's entirely likely that there'll be the topics of the affirmative answer to question one, the statutory question, the affirmative answer to media, and then the other things that are revealed in an individual board order, you will be talking to them about. So I'm not gonna be super strict about your individual board order, unless it's something you absolutely should ask in general or individual. And if you think you forgot something, you need to come up and ask me. And then, I'm interested in you all getting the information more than I am being super strict. I just don't want surprises, which I think is fair and reasonable on my part. For the staff?
Sounds good, Judge.
Well, regardless of that, are we done?
Yes.
In your opinion?
We don't have anything.
Are we there yet?
Yeah, we're done.
My grandchildren will say, are we there yet? From Mr.
Fogel. I agree. I mean, up until the last day of jury selection, the parties were pretty good together last time. So I think
hanging that up does not put you in the best favor.
I think I will
carry away from that topic.
I think that we'll. I think we'll work it out. We've got a plan, and I think we'll be fine.
I agree with everything you said. You all conducted the case very, very well at home, and then you will slow down to. All right, there being no other business for the day, but the recess, everyone has a good
day. Thank you. Thank you.